Reading, of all the festivals, is the most traditional in the sense that it's just a giant gig.
Whereas when I go back now in my mind and think about Reading, I always get the feeling, driving in this van along the English country road, of a safari trip.
I remember when I see on the paper that we were supposed to play in Reading. For us, it was, can't imagine it. It was, you know, the place where all the biggest have played. So we were a little, under pressure this day.
The heavens opened. That's one thing I do remember about that day. And then as soon as we stopped playing, the rain stopped as well. But you got that fantastic photo.
Yeah, big picture.
Steam rising off the crowd.
It was just chaos for me. I really absolutely hated it. I remember being so nervous that our tour manager literally had to push me on stage.
Funny, because as we went on, I think they sort of opened the gates about the same time, 5 minutes before, so all these people were rushing to try and get their good seat, probably watched the later bands that day. And so as we started playing, there was just like thousands of people just pouring in, which is much nicer than, you know, pouring out.
You know, the Reading audience I consider to be the most discerning audience in the world, and the most ruthless audience, and maybe discerning and ruthless to a level sometimes that some artists haven't appreciated. But actually, if you go down well in Reading, you've got a future.
The big ones are great, you know. If you're headlining and everything's going well, it's a great experience, you know, walking out in front of 30,000 people, however many people.
You just think to yourself, God, that's amazing, there's 70,000 people. I've never seen anything like that in my life. Well, sod it, I belong here, and I should be here, you know what I mean? We're damn good and we deserve to be out in front of an audience that big. But I think, you know, for a band at that stage in our career, you need that sort of all-conquering arrogance.
But I liked it so much, we gotta do it again.
Yeah.
Right now. Alright, right now?
Right now.
Right now.
Well, in my particular case, I'm a lifetime musician. My father played guitar. I would hear him playing, and I got the bug. So I started actually learning my first little chords and scales when I was maybe 5 or 6 years old, and I've always loved it. I always will love it.
No, the thing about it was I wanted to play guitar, so my parents wouldn't get me one. They said, no, you gave up the piano. It's like, well, did I? I suppose I did, really. And I saved up and got one from a catalogue. So it was like, it really was. And I never ever got a lesson or anything. What taught me was listening to like Undertones or the Ramones. You think, my God, when you hear Teenage Kicks, you thought, well, it's not that hard, yeah. You know, I can work that out.
There's only a few chords in that.
Our parents were telling us, you know, that's satanic life. We don't want you to go to pursue that area. You know, if you want to play guitar, play it in the church. In books, in songs, that's fine.
Oh, it's just a phase he's going through. A classic thing, and it's just like, I'm going to show her it's not a phase, you know.
I mean, you know, I think the first thing I remember was sort of lying on the floor looking at the With the Beatles album, going, John Paul, George Ringo, John Paul, George Ringo.
My mother always said that I was always playing around with like toy guitars and stuff like that when I was, you know, in my infancy, so, and I'd get, you know, kind of these kind of plastic orchestras together to play along to Beatles stuff and whatever. So, I mean, I always knew I wanted to make music. And I'm not much good for anything else. I think if I stack shelves, I'd probably kill someone. So, you know, it's best I stay on this path.
Well, I was kind of like working at the lumberyard, and my friend Gibby really wanted to start a band really bad, and he was writing songs, and I didn't want to do it, and then I finally went to practice with him one time and got hooked, and we started playing shows, and next thing I knew, I didn't care about not getting a job, and I left the lumberyard.
I hadn't a clue what was going on when I started. I really, really didn't, and I just like, I got it. Just, it was like all so amazing, you know. I mean, literally, I was at home in Galway running a whole food shop, you know, having babies and natural childbirth and breastfeeding classes with the LHA League and everything. And then I was like traveling all over the world, and I had a big band and a big crew and loads of drink, and like, I mean, God, I had my first gin and tonic when I was 30.
Well, there's millions of people like me, more talented, that never have the opportunity. You know, they end up going another route in their life. You know, and they're one of the lucky ones.
And that was the start. I bought a very good acoustic guitar and would play that acoustic guitar, the two of us. My friend would come from behind. I would be sitting like this, he would come from behind. And because he was taller than me and he had long fingers, he would be playing the bass lines up there, and I would be playing the other three strings, lower strings.
Short footage of that.
Yeah, okay. And he would be playing like that because it was only one guitar we had.
It was completely down to seeing the Sex Pistols, which is really weird because when we think about it, how much we've achieved musically, the chances of A, you forming a group after the Sex Pistols, and B, making that group successful, C, making another group successful, etc. The chances were, I think if any gambling man wouldn't have had that much of a bet on it.
There's one moment that really changed my life, in a sense. It was a gig by the Ruts in 1979, a pub in Bradford, 200 people there. And in that gig was everything that was wonderful, terrible, frightening, brilliant, exhilarating about being alive. And I walked into that gig not knowing what I wanted to do with my life. I walked out of that gig and that's what I want to do with my life. If I can ever make people feel a tenth as amazing as I felt tonight, I'll be happy.